Now, one of the most obvious and well-studied routes for hypnotic use in medicine is hypnotic analgesia. And we have known for a long time, of course, the pain pathways, lateral spinal thalamic tract, through the thalamus, periaqueductal gray, to sensory cortex. But we've also known for a long time that there are top-down ways of controlling pain. Back from the earliest days of conditioning experiments, when Pavlov noted that after a while, you had this paired association between a bell and food and after or a shock, and after a while, the dog stopped reacting as if it were getting the shock. And so there is, and we now know a phenomenon of central pain, where after a while you get a pain circuit going, and very little peripheral stimulus can produce a great deal of pain. As you see here, I think you can see that the baby is the one who's getting the shot, and the father is the one who's in pain. So the cortex has a lot to do with what we experience as painful or not. So we've used hypnosis in both chronic and acute pain. This is from a randomized trial we did studying the effects of group therapy for women with metastatic breast cancer. At the end of each weekly group, we taught them a self-hypnosis exercise. Imagine your body is floating in warm or cool water. You feel a pleasant sense of cool or warm tingling numbness. It filters the hurt out of the pain. Patients were taught to do this on their own. And by the end of the year, the women getting this emotional support and training in self-hypnosis had half the pain the control group did on the same and very low amounts of medication. We replicated, it only takes about 15 years to replicate these studies, we replicated the study and got basically the same effect, that the women in the support groups had significantly less pain than the women in the control condition. Here, this is one for the Institute here. It's early acupuncture. That's odd, my neck suddenly feels better. We have also found it very useful in acute pain. So Avira Lang was at Stanford. She's now in Boston, and colleagues and I put together an experiment where we recruited 241 patients who had to have percutaneous renal procedures. That means an arterial cutdown, threading cameras, or doing chemoembolization through arteries. These procedures last 2 to 3 hours. They're painful. They're fraught with worry for patients involved in them. And we had three conditions: standard care, structured attention, and a hypnotic relaxation condition as well. The standard treatment, they all had patient-controlled analgesia. They had an IV they could press a button and give themselves opiates. Everybody had that. In one other condition, they had a friendly nurse who was just trying to comfort them. And in the third, a trained nurse who was teaching them to do self-hypnosis for pain and anxiety control. And here you see their ratings of pain over the 3 hours of the procedures. And the pain gets worse and worse despite piling on more and more medication in the standard care group. So it's up to about 7 out of 10 by the end of the procedures. The friendly nurse helped. The pain scores were about 4. Here's the hypnosis group. The pain scores were down to 1 by the end of the study. This is their anxiety scores. And you can see, again, 7 in standard care, about 4, 3 to 4 in structured support. And I was afraid the hypnosis patients had all died because they had no anxiety at all by the end of about 2 hours. Now, also notice that this line is shorter than the other two. And I'll get back to why that was the case. The hypnosis group used half as much pain medication as the standard care group, so they had less onboard meds. The average procedure duration was 17 minutes shorter in the hypnosis group. And this was because they were more comfortable, they were having fewer complications from medication, and you know what? Because the treatment team was less anxious as well. The patients were so obviously comfortable that the treatment team was better able to perform the work that they had to do. And there were far more procedural complications in the hypnosis group than the standard care group. In addition, we saved $338 a procedure because they were shorter, despite having the extra person in the room. Now, this is a frustration that your institute deals with more than most, and that is, if you had a drug that did this, that shortened procedure time, reduced complications, saved $338 a procedure, every hospital in the country would be using it, right? But, you know, who is going to promote this? You know, we don't have any pharma reps going around selling hypnosis. In the old days, at least, we used dangling watches to hypnotize people. We could maybe get watch companies to go around. But we don't do that anymore. So it is not as widely used as it should be, simply because I think there's no intervening industry to push it. We did a similar study among children. Lisa Butler, who's now at the University of Buffalo, and a number of colleagues, Linda Shortliff, who's a professor of urological surgery at Stanford. We heard stories about these horrible experiences of young kids screaming on the floor of the radiology suites. They had to have children who need voiding cystourethrograms who have urinary reflux up to the kidneys. The ureters, it's a kind of interesting natural phenomenon that most ureters go into the kidney, into the bladder at an angle. And so when the bladder contracts, it automatically closes reflux back up to the kidneys. But some kids have a perpendicular ureter. And so when the bladder contracts, they force urine back up to the kidneys. Now, some outgrow it. It's major surgery to fix it. So what they do is scan these kids using a voiding cystourethrogram where you fill the bladder with contrast and have them urinate and see whether they're still getting reflux back to the kidneys. And the kids hate it. It's painful. It's embarrassing. They remember it from last year, and they're sensitized. Some parents lie to the kids. They say, we're going out for an ice cream, and they wind up at the procedure suite. And so it's a nightmare. And, of course, the more the kid struggles and cries, the harder it is to cath them and get the thing done. So we started a program where we would randomly assign half of them to come meet with me or one of my colleagues. We hypnotized, measured their hypnotizability, hypnotized them, taught them to imagine they were somewhere else. You know, you're playing with a friend, you're going to Disneyland, whatever you want to do. We made a list, and the mother and I would be there in the suite exchanging suggestions to the kids about where they really were. So you're playing a trick on your doctors, your body needs to be here, but you don't, so we're going somewhere else. So we did a randomized trial. We had the kids rate how unpleasant it was using a rating scale that kids like to use. The parents' reports were that the hypnosis was significantly more comfortable for the kids. The average distress during the procedure, the yellow line here, was less, particularly during the cath prep and the catheterization, which is the worst part of the procedure for the kids. The highest distress during the procedure was lower in the hypnosis group than in the control condition. The professionals' reports, the technician in particular, said it was twice as easy to do the procedure with hypnosis. The total time, again, was 18 minutes shorter, and that's a long 18 minutes for these kids. So it was much more comfortable, easier for them to do. And so, again, if this were a just world, every time they do a VCUG, the kids would be taught this, but that's not yet what's happening, unfortunately. So we can modulate hypnosis can be useful in modulating perception, changing attention systems like the anterior cingulate. The dorsolateral prefrontal cortex is involved, the insulin, other dopaminergic pathways. Oh, I've already showed you this one. So that's just an example. In chronic pain, it works as well. And there are other investigators of Vera Lang doing it during biopsy for diagnosis of breast cancer. And actually, Guy Montgomery at Mount Sinai Hospital in New York has done a very good randomized trial showing that it works during actual lumpectomies for breast cancer. Just using hypnosis as the sole anesthesia works extremely well. This is how they use hypnosis at other institutions, not ours. The way we treat a headache is to divert your attention to something else.